السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. Let me begin by thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for giving me another opportunity to meet with my brothers and sisters, the Muslim community, especially in Adelaide in South Australia and also around the world. It is part of the programs, live Facebook programs, advices, sharing some burning issues, important things, every night organized by the Islamic Society of South Australia. The brothers and sisters, let me just begin by congratulating all of you with two important things. Number one is the current situation we are living, coronavirus, for the last 3 days, consecutive days, alhamdulillah, there was no new coronavirus case in South Australia. And that is a big good news for all of us. And it is the beginning of the ease, inshallah, that we will, inshallah, come out of this lockdown situation. And our aim is to, inshallah, by the grace of Allah, to live this important days that we are waiting for, inshallah, to go to normal. That's our hope, that's our prayer. Second good news, second congratulation I would like to share with you all, that our long-awaited guest, the best friend of the Muslims, the most blessed time of the whole year, the month of Ramadan, is just a couple of days away from us. It's right at our door, knocking on our doors, giving us the reminding that, yes, I am here. Are you ready to receive me? So as Muslims, we need to be ready to receive the month of Ramadan. And with this, I would like to just remind myself and others that this is a time that we should all unite and we should stop fight. When I say fight, it's not a physical fight I'm talking about. The fight or arguing on things when we are not specialized in the field. Leave the matter to the people who are learned. فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ Allah says, ask the people of knowledge if you don't know. So one of the things, unfortunate things that which has been happening, and actually it's not unfortunate among the learned people, among the scholars, because this is how they see is the rahmah or the mercy of Islam, that they can share their opinion. They can share what they extract from the text, and they share their opinion as part of their ijtihad. And it's been going on for centuries. And one of the common things we face is the beginning of the month of Ramadan. When do we start it? We all know we start the month of Ramadan with the sighting of the moon. But this hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has been explained in many ways. And one of them is the possibility of sight on the moon. And there are people who go through the scientific sight on the moon. And there are people who go by sight on the moon with your own naked eyes and then decide on the month of Ramadan. And alhamdulillah, all these three views seems different, but at the same time, they're all supportive to each other. So what I want to say is that let's unite. Let's follow the Islamic body in the country we live. If it is a Muslim country, then we must follow and respect the announcement made by the country, by the government, Muslim government. And definitely there is always a moon sighting group who take this, who give this decision. And if you are living in the countries like this, then alhamdulillah, we have Muslim organizations. We need to follow and support. And because there are also relying on the views of the imams and scholars. And alhamdulillah, in Australia, we have a very strong umbrella of Islamic organization, Islamic body, which is ANIC, Australian National Imams Council. They are the ones who work together, collaborate with all other imams around Australia, more than 200 imams, and they share their decision at the beginning of Ramadan or in any situation which is related to the Muslims. So this is one. But the real thing for the Muslims, for the lay person, is that we should leave the matter to the imams and the masjids and the organization to announce it, and we follow. But as individuals, we need to really worry about two important things. Number one, am I prepared for Ramadan? Second one is reflection of the past Ramadan, that how we lived, and this coming month, coming Ramadan, which is going to be unique, very, very different one that we all know for many various reasons. And being the reason of coronavirus, which is actually making us to stay home, not being able to go to the masajid to pray Salat Taraweeh, and there are many other Ramadan activities that we time to time, like we normally perform, or it's became part of our life. Unfortunately, it's not going to happen the way we want it. So we should plan for this Ramadan differently, totally different from what we used to plan in the past Ramadans. Previous Ramadans, it's a routine. We know when it starts, we start Ramadan. We know when to go to Taraweeh prayer and organizing iftar parties, this and that. And alhamdulillah, Muslims used to live the month of Ramadan together. And that was the sign, like, you know, we try to show our unity and care and share with each other. But this Ramadan is a bit different. But can we have the same activities? Can we perform the same activities which we used to do in the previous Ramadan? Yes, we can. By all means, we can, with slight difference. For example, fasting the month of Ramadan, which is one of the pillars of Islam, which no one can change it or replace it with some other month or give an excuse not to fast. We all have to fast because we believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is the one who sets the time for us. We follow that time and we start fasting. Except for that other excuse that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allowed. For example, someone who is sick, someone who is unable to fast due to his old age or traveling. Those are the excuses, but that missed days must be completed or made up by afterwards. Second one is the Salat Taraweeh, which is the most talked about topic now among all Muslims. And I personally received lots of messages from my congregation, from the brothers and sisters. What is going to happen to our Taraweeh prayer? The answer is very simple and straightforward. Taraweeh prayer is number one, it is a sunnah prayer. And it is one of the sunnahs that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam encouraged Muslims to perform. And Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did perform Salat Taraweeh in the masjid 3 consecutive nights with the Muslims, but then he said, pray at home. So it is a sunnah prayer. And it was encouraged to pray at home, but later on in the time of Umar radiallahu anhu, during the times of Sahaba, they all agreed to pray it in the masjid and became ijma', consensus of the scholars, and all the companies agreed. And since then, it continued like that. So it means if we are praying Salat Taraweeh at home, we are still performing the sunnah, which was done by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and practiced by the Sahabas in the early times. So as long as you pray at home, Salatul Isha together with your family members, and pray Salat Taraweeh, that does the same thing. But maybe you might think that, okay, what is the reward of going to the masjid? Where we get it from? You get it the same one through your niyyah, intention. If you're honest with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you had that genuine intention that you would go to the masjid if it is possible, then you will get the reward of praying Salat Taraweeh with Jama'ah in the masjid, inshallah. Second one is the iftars. To invite people, want to get reward. Because if a person invites another Muslim for iftar and provides food, and Prophet said even one glass of milk or one glass of water to break the fast, the person will get the reward of that fasting of the person without Allah decreasing the reward of fasting of that person who fasted. So the giving of food to a person who is fasting will give you extra reward of fasting the whole day. But in this Ramadan, probably it's not going to happen, but we can still continue doing the same thing, same activity, a little bit different way. For example, sending or giving our money, the food, to those who are deprived, who are less fortunate, those who are less privileged. And there are so many, millions. And alhamdulillah, there are so many beautiful organizations who are working tirelessly to be bridge between us and them, like Human Appeals, Islamic Relief, and there are many more. Hasana, for example, they're doing, they're running the food package for Ramadan, and they're distributing it in worldwide. And they try to reach to those people who are really, really in need of our help. Now, you can do this. You can give iftar to those people through your donations, through your sadaqah, and that's exactly the same, and even it's better. Because when you invite people around you, you're inviting people who already have something to eat. And that is still okay. But when you're giving something to those who are deprived, who really need your help, you are doing sadaqah and iftar invitation, and also the reward will be amazing. Now, another thing we get worried sometimes, you know, the brothers and sisters who love to come to a specific masjid where they want to recite and listen to the whole Quran, Khatmul Quran, finishing the whole Quran in 1 month, in the month of Ramadan, is something good. It's a rewarding action, one of the good ibadah, the worship activities. But you can still do it at home. Set a time in your family, every day in the morning, or in the afternoon or in the evening. Just recite one juz per night together, and try to do it in a circle that everyone in the family recites one page at a time. So in circle, so everyone listening and reciting, and spend some time, 5 to 10 minutes, just looking at the meaning, important lessons of that surah that you recite, and that will benefit all of you. And that is one of the ways of improving our social life at home, our social environment at home. And Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to encourage Muslims that they should not turn their houses into graveyards. Like, that means that just not doing any ibadah at home. We must pray at home. We must recite Quran at home. We must continue doing azkar at home. These are the things that we can do. And as zakah also, another important that Muslims love to give zakah in the month of Ramadan, especially in this month of Ramadan, when there are people who are really struggling compared to the previous Ramadans, because many people, the amount of people who became the recipients of zakah are increased due to the situation that they lost their jobs, unemployment, and many more reasons, closed their businesses, and there are people who probably turned into bankruptcy. So those people need our zakah, and we have to stick to those 8 categories that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran, and we should give zakah. And in this kind of situations, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam allowed even paying zakah for upfront for 2 years. And that's what he took from his uncle Abbas radiallahu anhu in a year when there was a really starvation and difficulty, financial difficulty of the Muslim community. So he, Abbas radiallahu anhu, uncle asked him, can I pay 2 years upfront? Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said yes, and he received his zakah and distributed to the poor people. So we need to be a little bit more generous in this time of the year. Now, some people also think of, like, you know, especially in the month of Ramadan, they love to perform Umrah. And it's one of the amazing ibadah, that performing Umrah in Ramadan is better than the Umrah performed outside Ramadan. So in this one, yes, everything is closed now. We can't travel to Mecca. We can't even travel from Adelaide to Melbourne, even interstate. So we can still travel with our intention, by doing some simple activities, simple actions, and we still can get the reward of performing Umrah in the month of Ramadan. And that is Adhkar al-Sabah wal-Masa. Doing Adhkar in the morning. Pray your Fajr with your family, on time, with Jama'ah. Sit down where you are, on your praying mat. Finish your Tasbih, Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, Allahu Akbar. And then do this Adhkar al-Sabah, the du'as that you say in the morning. Recite Quran. Keep yourself busy with the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala until the sunrise. And then after the sunrise, you get up, pray 2 rak'ah. You finish. That means by doing that, you get the reward of performing full umrah, as Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned, with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So in Islam, reaching to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is very easy. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows our heart. He judges us according to our intentions and actions and ikhlas. If we have the right intention, if we do good deeds, and if you are sincere, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepts it. And amazingly, Ramadan is such a an action, a ibadah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he took upon himself that I will reward for the fasting people, my servants who fast, and he didn't put any limit. And this is the most important time of the year. We must know the importance of it, and we must be prepared for it, and we must remain united during the month of Ramadan by being close to each other, by sharing the goodness with each other, and by avoiding all types of things which leads to disunity, disagreement, argument, calling you and me type of thing. We need to stop it. Because among the things which actually stays as a barrier between us and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ill feeling towards another Muslim. Even when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promises to forgive his servants, he excludes some people. He says, I'm not going to accept these two as long as they remain against each other, as long as they carry enmity and hatred against each other. Let them reconcile and then I will forgive them. So dear Muslims, we must purify our hearts. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tests us how we behave towards him. And if we want Allah's mercy, Allah's forgiveness, let's start it from within. Forgive each other. Have a sound heart, peaceful heart towards each other. And be at the service of each other. We ask Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the blessing of this month, to give us tawfiq to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us. We ask Allah to forgive the sins of people, sins of the Muslims, and remove the calamities and hardships that people are facing now, and especially those Muslims, brothers and sisters. Lastly, I would like to remind everyone to remember them in your du'as, those people who are deprived from fasting, not because they don't have food to eat, not because of this and that, just because they are Muslims. And those who deprive them, stop them, ban them from fasting, ban them to pray, not banning them to go to the masjid due to the coronavirus, no, banning them from the masjid just because they are Muslims, and destroying their masajid, forcing them to eat pork, and by force they turn on them, trying to turn them into disbelievers. Those are the people who are really facing the real pain, real suffering. We must remember them in our du'as. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala remove this hardship, this calamity from them, and give them ease, and give them what is best for them. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.